Hello, welcome. This is The Big Fight. And we're going to turn our attention today to an issue that periodically keeps coming up. And now the Law Commission has drawn attention to it. Many people are saying it's not a bad idea. Others are saying it's a terrible idea. It's not going to work. It's not practical. It's anti-democracy and what have you. What am I talking about? Simultaneous elections. That specifically means a concept which says that we should have elections once in 5 years. There's another version which says have them once a year only, but at one particular time. But the basic concept says let's have elections to the Lok Sabha at the same time as we're having elections for the Assembly, which means the entire country will vote once in 5 years, both for the Prime Minister and for the Chief Ministers of various states, which means potentially the country gets out of the mode of being perennially in campaign mode. We will hopefully have less abuse, less people shouting at each other, less problems with the model code of conduct, and so on and so forth. There are some obvious advantages to it. The disadvantages, how are you going to do it? How is it practical? What happens if you have a hung assembly? What happens if a government gets voted out? And by the way, is all of this some sort of a conspiracy by the government of the day to get some advantage? Advantage in states from the center. That's roughly a sense of what the issues have been. Now, we've got many of the top experts to join us in taking us through these points and seeing which of them actually makes sense. And it's a pleasure to be starting off by welcoming Dr. S.Y. Qureshi, who has former Chief Election Commissioner of India, has looked at this, of course, in great detail. He's also written a book about how Indian elections work, so the best person to talk about this. Shaina NC is joining us, spokesperson of the BJP. Great, Shaina, to have you with us. The BJP, obviously, one of the parties which has been strongly welcoming this, as indeed have other parties at the Biju Janata Dal. So Pinaki Mishra joining us to tell us why he thinks it's a good idea. The Congress party, by the way, doesn't think it's a good idea. Mohammed Khan joining us to tell us why he doesn't think it's a good idea. We have with us Sanjay Kumar, Director, Lok Niti CSDS, who's also somewhat not quite convinced that it is going to be a workable or a feasible idea. And Shahid Siddiqui, editor Naidunia, is going to be joining us to help us understand this. And Vikas Singh is joining us, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court, who may help us in understanding some of the legalities around it all. Shaina, why don't I start with you? This is something which the government seems to have been talking about it for a while. The Prime Minister, I think, also believes that this is the right thing to do. Some would say the BJP wants to take advantage of the positioning of Narendra Modi and that advantage that you may get in a central Lok Sabha election and transferring that into states as a result of that. What's the reason why the BJP thinks this is a good idea?
Well, our Prime Minister has constantly said that it is time the nation works. We are always in election mode. You go from one state to another, to another, to a bipoll, to all kinds of municipal corporation elections. You have assembly elections, and then you have this big grand election, the Lok Sabha elections. So I think the kind of time, energy that we waste in elections really does not let the administration, because of model code of conduct, the administrators, the leaders who are constantly campaigning, who lose so much time. So I think it's about time that as a mature democracy, we deliberate on this. And I'm so glad that the first state that actually supported the Prime Minister's suggestion is Uttar Pradesh, even though they have up until 2024, and they have the highest mandate that we have seen in recent times. So it is, you know, you need to think about the country first and then about your individual states. I've heard this argument that regional parties would not take well to it. Well, it's high time regional parties too realize there is national interest above anything else. And if you want a country that is performing on policies, that is implementing policies and is in work mode, for the first time you actually have the bureaucracy and the administration scared of this government because of the values that Prime Minister Modi has set. Look at the way he works, how hardworking he is, how focused he is, and how eager he is to implement policies. And if you're going to be in election mode, you go from one state to the other, you finish Gujarat, you go to another state, you go to another state, you go to Karnataka. From Karnataka, you head to Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Rajasthan. Then you go in for the local, the grand 2019 elections. Post that, you have Maharashtra. You go on and on. So where is the time lost being accounted for? And I think that this is really the vision of a statesman who is thinking about country before self and party's gain.
Okay. The politics of it is something that we will turn to. Whom does it help politically? Whom does it hurt politically? And how does that work is an interesting question. But let me just get everyone else to weigh in on that. China outlining the theoretical reason why this should actually work very well. So, Mohammed Khan, let me just ask you to lay out for us, why is what she's saying not, and it seems to make sense, let's not be in election mode, let's have elections only once every 5 years and spend the rest of the time on development.
There is a word that our former Vice President, Mr. Hamid Ansari, used earlier in this context, and the word used was impractical. This is a man with 5 decades of administrative experience and whose credentials are beyond doubt. But aside from that, this entire suggestion baffles me, and it baffles me why this question is being given so much time, attention, and resources by the government at this stage. Because this is a question, as Mr. Qureshi will attest, was answered in 2010 during the Electoral Commission's report, and on December 2015 by the Standing Committee on Law and Justice. You need a constitutional amendment. There is no provision or article in the Constitution of India that allows you to dissolve assemblies. Shaina ji spoke about UP, and I just want to quickly touch upon that. That argument is self-defeating. If you are in power in 19 states, very proudly you tell the rest of the nation, right? Dissolve the assemblies in those 19 states, pass resolution in those assemblies and go to simultaneous polls there. But they won't do that. This is lip service, and this entire exercise is a distraction.
So, three things. Look, I'm just going to try and get everyone's comments in, and let's try and put these into different issues. One, is it a good idea? Number two, is it a practical idea? Can it be done? Can it not be implemented? What will be required to make it work? Constitutional amendments, dissolution of states, all of those other practical aspects of it. And a third, of course, is there a political reason this, and there's some big political conspiracy behind it. Pinaki, you represent a regional party, but a regional party which actually believes it's a good idea. And the reason you probably believe it's a good idea is because Odisha has one state which does have simultaneous elections together with the Lok Sabha.
And that's not by accident. In 2005, the Odisha Assembly was due for elections in February, March 2005. But Atalji called for early elections in March, April of 2004. Naveen Patnaik, unprecedented in the annals of modern Indian politics, slashed his term. He had a full majority, slashed his term by 1 year so that he would have coterminous elections. So, and after that, 2000...
He also knew he was going to win at that time.
Well, we've had elections in there simultaneously in 2004, 9, 14, and now, of course, whenever the central government elections are on. So, just a quick correction. Shainaji said that UP is the first one to jump on board and said that let's have simultaneous elections, and they're on till 24. That's wrong. They're on only till 22. So actually for UP, there will have to be a 7-year term is why they'll be very happy, because it'll be 2022. And then if they want to go
the practicalities of it are actually, are we going to extend people's terms or cut people's terms?
I had a meeting yesterday with the Law Commission. The idea is, because we represent the BJD's position there, and we support it, of course, but the Law Commission's viewpoint will be that elections which are due up to 2019 end should be preponed. And thereafter, 2020 onwards, they will have to be given an extension up to the next Lok Sabha term, so UP will get a happy 2-year extra term.
From the point of view of practicality, let's be very clear. This is not likely to go through in time for 2019.
It's a good idea.
One is, is it a good idea? How long will it take to implement this? There are very few people who have a roadmap in getting this done for less than 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, who knows. Sanjay, even if it's a good idea, it can't. First of all, is it a good idea or a bad idea? Let me stick to my chain of thoughts.
I would say if there is a cycle of election which suggests that there are some states where election needs to be held along with the Lok Sabha election, hold it simultaneously. No harm in doing that. But I think forcing all the state by law to hold elections on one single day, I think that's not a good idea. But I would like to focus more on the political aspect of that.
I'll come to the political aspect a little later in the show. But on this aspect of it, so you're saying it's not a good idea. What's wrong with the thesis that China was saying, get us out of election mode? I mean, frankly, we spend so much time in politics, right? Switch on your television channels. All you're seeing is yelling and screaming and hatred, and maybe it'll continue because that's the way you get TRPs from it. But there's potentially
Short-term ad hoc policies,
model code of conduct, get away with all of that and say election once in 5 years. So as a concept, what's wrong with that?
I'll come to the practicality and the politics. As a concept, what's right or wrong with it?
I think if elections take place in one state, there is no need that if the model code of conduct is implemented in that state, it should have an impact in other states. So if you're holding elections in Tamil Nadu, why to have model code of conduct being implemented in UP and other states? So this logic of that all the time countries in a mode of election, all the time there is a model code of conduct being implemented time and again, and the government is not able to function, I think government has enough time. In 5 years' time, you get 4.5 years to function. If you're not able to deliver in 4.5 years, you want to deliver everything when the model code of conduct is in place. So I don't buy this argument.
That's a good theoretical argument against it. China, can I just get you in on that? The argument that he's making is that a model code of conduct in Punjab doesn't necessarily affect a model code of doesn't affect governance in Karnataka or vice versa. So it's only for that short period of time that a model code of conduct is kicking in. The other aspect of being in campaign mode and this constant, you know, communal and casteist and other rhetoric which comes up at election time, it's possible that that will not go away for the simple reason that it doesn't suit many people to allow that to go away. I mean, what would happen to TRPs if channels stopped encouraging hate speech?
Well, obviously the government's not working for channels, TRPs. The government's working for the larger interest of people of this country. And really, if you ask somebody as learned as Mr. Qureshi, he'll tell you that the kind of manpower required for elections, state on state, city to city, village to village, is a Herculean job. And I'm not saying that this cannot be the same phased out manner in 2019 or if you have a single election, but we must understand the kind of money we're going to be saving. I mean, our party has at least had the courage of conviction to come up with electoral reforms when it comes to funding. The fact that you have donations which are reduced, people who can contribute legitimately through electoral bonds. I think
government
that
has
all
taken.
This is a progressive state.
You have been the single largest beneficiary
nation,
of anonymous
goal.
Donations.
One
you received 90% of all donations.
Point.
You have taken away the right of the public to know who donates.
Sir,
we have opposed this as a regressive step.
I'm very sad for you that you haven't received the donations that you seem to be very bitter
Ma'am,
about.
I hope you receive
but
more donations, but at least have the courage of your convictions, as you say, to disclose
who
who's donating to you.
I don't
to demonstrate
it,
that there's no quid pro quo. If you have nothing
to
hide,
who gets
if you are
more.
Indeed champions
the
of transparency, disclose to the people who are donating to you as you so proudly put it.
Is it necessary? One moment, Mr. Mahmud Khan. I can understand your sense of resentment that parties do not get funding if they are not popular and you fall in that bracket.
Ma'am, I know you see everything through the prism of electoral
it is for the
politics.
People of this country
but the question here is about electoral bonds. It's a regressive
okay.
step.
Okay.
You have taken a step back from transparency.
Can I pose this one at a time? One at a time.
You, no matter what
one
you
at a time. One at a time. We'll get back to political. We'll get back to the politics later. China, just finish what you were saying. Yeah.
One party in the state, so don't be so insecure about your political future.
Okay.
I just want to say, Vikram, we don't have to be insecure about our political future. If you do well in the center, people will vote for you. If you do well in the state, who says that they will not vote for you? Of course, the electorate is extremely intelligent in India, but look at the service we'd be doing to the country. You can have politicians who are working, who are in work mode. You can have the bureaucracy and all the technocrats, bureaucrats, all the election officials who don't need to go scouting from state to state, city to city, village to village, and actually utilize that time for implementation of policies and nation building.
China.
We are choosing to only view this as a selfish propaganda of people who have a certain agenda, whether it's regional parties, whether it's Congress, I don't want to comment. I only want to say that if we are saving so much money, if people are seeing performance-based politics, why
okay.
not welcome
fair
it?
Enough.
We got
the thrust of your argument, so obviously this is a debatable point whether
sure
it's going to...
sure that each election is a money-spinning churn for certain political parties.
Okay. Chai, let me get you in and Vikas in. From a slightly neutral position, what... Is it good? Is it a good idea or a bad idea?
Vikram, it's a good idea, but it's just an idea. If you want to implement it on the ground, then you have a lot of problems. It's like a medicine which may be good for a certain disease, but may have a lot of side effects which may be much more damaging than the cure to a disease.
What's and the side effects?
Yeah, side effects will be, you see, India was conceived as a federal system. In a federal system, you knew that there will be different parties emerging, which will be different from the party at the center. In the states, you will have different kind of parties. If you want to bring all of them together into a certain mode.
But historically speaking, the first two decades, you did have simultaneous.
Let me finish. That was the case, but gradually a system evolves. A system is not born. A constitution is not born. Constitution gradually evolves. So first two decades don't explain Indian constitution. Indian constitution can be explained in the next 7 decades or coming 3 decades that it will really evolve into what would it evolve into. And therefore, this idea, if you are constantly in election mode, if the Prime Minister is constantly in election mode, if you are in the polarization mode, that is much more damaging. And if that is the case, then if you have elections every year, I am all for election on a particular date every year.
So you mean 4 years? So your point is 4 years, the country will proceed normally, and in the 5th year, polarization will start.
If the polarization starts there constantly, if the Prime Minister is campaigning in every by-election, if the Prime Minister is campaigning even in assembly, corporation elections, then the polarization is very much there, and you can't work because of the whole system, the whole cabinet is there in Gujarat, campaigning for the party.
That's a valid point, the way elections are happening.
Okay,
let me just quickly turn to the audience and do some quick unscientific snap polling. In this audience, how many of you think that simultaneous elections would be a good idea? Nobody. Not one of you. Okay, one person. Why do you think it's a good idea?
I believe it's a good idea, but then it's just a good idea. You need to implement it in a very good way. Like, there shall be proper implementation measures, you should also tell the people about it.
Okay, fair enough. Now the gentleman next to you, yeah.
Like, all parties fight for one party. Suppose I'm taking it like politically, BJP, all party together fighting elections in one time, so then they're all together, then they will lose in all states also. If even they have done good work also there.
Okay, that's a potential theory. Anybody else have a comment?
Democracy is all about decentralizing. So it's like if we do the elections together, we'll be centralizing power together.
Okay, now the gentleman here, yeah. Last comment.
In my opinion, it is not possible. Because all the security problem will be there. How will it? All country will be studied. How is it possible?
Okay, interesting question. How are you going to manage the security around having simultaneous elections in every state?
You can't hold an election in small state. How can you hold the whole country?
Okay, the feasibility of it is a very interesting question which we should turn our attention to. Vikas, let me just get you in the legalities of this just for a minute. Because A, how are you going to implement the system? Presumably the constitution is going to have to be amended. Who's going to get the numbers to be able to amend the constitution? Which is why I'm saying it's not likely that this is going to happen in the next 6 months, 1 year, 5 years, a decade, who knows how long it will take. That's issue number one. Issue number two, other practical issues constantly keep coming up. Let's say you have simultaneous elections. Let's say that a particular state government loses power, loses mandate, there's a dead, whatever happens. Parties switch, coalitions break after 2.5 years. Then what happens? Do you have president's rule for 2 years? Does that party then get out of step? What happens?
Well, nobody can doubt that this is something which is very good for the country. Nobody can doubt that. But it is more a utopian idea. It is not something which can at all be implemented in a country like this, especially 70 years down the line after independence. Why we say it is good, as my friend also just now pointed out, the BJP, for instance, banks only on Mr. Modi. Now, Mr. Modi is the Prime Minister. So, if there is an election anywhere, poor Modi is taken all around because he is the only face on which they don't have a regional leader. All these states that have gone to poll, they didn't have any chief ministerial candidate. They go to poll on the basis of Modi, and then somebody, nobody knew of, somebody is picked up as a chief minister. So, if you have regional leaders, this problem will not be there.
That's
so,
true.
It's a national leader who is everywhere. So, obviously, governance in the center will be affected because he has to canvass
but
everywhere.
But that's a BJP-specific point. It's not necessarily a point
and
for
that's why they are so worried about it.
That's why they are so worried.
Yes,
but the real point is, Vikram, as far as legality is concerned, you can't force states to go for election. Because then if you are wanting to do that, you are dismissing governments prior to their term, which is contrary to what they will want to do. Or if you want to have a constitutional amendment, then that constitutional amendment will also entail that the government will not fall happen what may. So you will have to have a government in place for the entire term. So even if you lose majority...
So one of the ways of solving that is to say that you can only have a vote of no confidence if there's a positive vote of confidence immediately after that.
No. Even if there is a... Even if you have a no confidence...
You take from the German constitution and others, where you say you can only have a negative vote of confidence. I mean, you can't have a negative vote of no confidence. You have to have a positive vote of confidence in
someone. The government will remain.
So the government doesn't fall.
The particular policy will not go through. The government will have to work out a more inclusive policy so that the others are taken around, but the government will not fall. That's the only way you can do it. Otherwise, it can't be done.
We're discussing all this in theory. Let's just turn to the man who's actually done this and who's therefore studied it at great length. Dr. Qureshi, just take us through this. We're trying to debate whether it's a good idea or it's a bad idea, but even one of the other issues is whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, is it something which is at all feasible? You being Chief Election Commissioner, can it be done? Simultaneous elections.
Well, actually, I have a very nuanced view on this because there are good points and there are bad points. The good points are the two mainly which were mentioned by the Prime Minister, that there's a lot of expenditure, I agree. Then because of the model code, normal work comes to a standstill, normal work. Plus, I would like to add two more points to this. One, that since the elections have become a source of main source of corruption, if we are in the election mode always, we are in the corruption mode always. And fourthly, which is the most important, all the communalism, casteism, all polarization happens just before the election. So let it happen once in 5 years and let there be peace for 5 years. So therefore, for these four reasons, simultaneous election is a good idea. But there are equally strong points against it. Now, for instance, the federal issue which has been discussed, I have missed a part of the debate. That's one issue. Suppose the Lok Sabha falls, which he did in 13 days, and suppose we had the simultaneous election situation, what happened to the 28 state assemblies, which come to power with the absolute majority just because Lok Sabha falls? So we must have an election there also. And then, of course, local issues get mixed up. The accountability, the MP, they don't show their face for 5 years. If there are repeated elections, at least they have to keep going back to the voter. So these are the points in favor of the staggered election. But from the point of view of election commission, that is the most convenient thing. For instance, the voter is the same, polling station is the same, security arrangement is the same, machine is the... Of course, we require three times the number of machines. Therefore, there are the good and bad points. However, I would like to say that recently, now, the original proposal was to have simultaneous election at all three tiers. Now they will stop talking of panchayat elections. Now 30 lakh were elected the representatives from at that year. You are not even talking about it now. Then secondly, the formulation came that if you can't have election once in 5 years, let us have twice in 5 years for further dilution. With all that dilution, then what is left? And finally, I would like to say that recently when you could not hold simultaneous election to just two states, Gujarat and Himachal, which were always simultaneous, because politically...
And I think the Congress failed there. They should have actually gone to court. I feel very strongly on that. This was a classic case where the Congress failed.
Let me complete. Now, not to talk of two elections, two states, Karnataka elections, and there were 16 by-elections, which should normally be held with Karnataka. They were held 25 days later. So what happened to the 25 days of prolonged model code of conduct? So ethically also, that moral authority of this proposal has been diluted totally.
Okay. Very interesting points. Let me come back to some of the people who are saying it's a great idea on the practical difficulties of this. Shana, let me start off by getting you in on this. So some of the specific points that have been made, which you've been hearing outlined as to what the problems with it are. How can this be implemented without constitutional amendments, number one? Number two, what happens in all of these cases? Because theoretically, governments will fall. So the minute we can try and somehow squeeze all elections in at one particular time, if let's say the BJP wins by a landslide in 2019, you'll have the Rajya Sabha, you'll have state governments, you may even be able to push through a constitutional amendment in time for 2024. But for the future, there will always be a time when a state government can fall or a Lok Sabha government can fall. Something can happen and then you get out of step again. How do you solve for that?
So this is not propaganda for the BJP. So let's understand that this is not about BJP winning and losing elections. We will do so on our own merit and own steam and our cadre, which happens to be the largest political party in the world today. So I don't want to go into that. So we don't require one nation, one poll to win elections because we're anyway winning. That is a second issue. As long as we perform, people repose faith in us, we will win.
But I'll come to the politics of this a little later in the program,
look
as
at
I
the
said.
Why,
the, we'll come to the
Qureshi
politics of it.
Made,
I'm just
Qureshi
trying to figure out the mechanics
two,
of it now.
Qureshi ji made just 2 points. Yeah, yeah. Qureshi ji just made 2 points. One is that you do away with this incessant corruption, election after election, where money does not need to be wasted. Rather, it should be used on public good. Second, you asked about how do you do it. So now say you have the assembly and the Lok Sabha elections together. There could be a hung assembly in one odd state. And if there needs to be a re-election, I'm sure the expertise of the Law Commission and the people in the election commission would be in a position to advise us as to how we should take on those kind of unusual, exceptional situations.
But hang on, China, how is it an unusual situation? China, assuming we're all agreeing that it's a good idea, hang on. Assuming we're all agreeing it's a good idea, then we are sitting and saying, now how do we implement this in practice? This is an obvious problem. So there's no point in kicking the ball down and saying, yes, we'll be able to figure it out somehow.
Unfortunately,
let's have an idea as to how we... could potentially resolve it. That's how you take the debate forward, right? Okay, if this problem comes up, let's try and find a solution.
Unfortunately, on the public domain so far, there is no suggestion of what constitutional amendments they are even thinking of. So unfortunately, it's just an idea. The Prime Minister speaks about it, the Law Minister speaks about it, but nobody has spelled out what constitutional amendments.
I'm trying to put it together, which is very sad.
Because that's the
homework. I'm going to come to Sanjay, but Pinaki, you also think it's a good idea. Okay, Pinaki, you think it's a good idea? Hang on. In Orissa, it has worked all this time. Why has it worked all this time? Because the BJD has been winning comfortably election after election. So far. Now, help us solve this problem. China says we will eventually be able to figure it out. I'm saying help us understand what the solution is.
Article 83.2, which says the House of the People, unless sooner dissolved, shall continue for 5 years. Similarly, Article 172.1, every legislature, assembly of every state, unless sooner dissolved. Unless sooner dissolved, simply has to be eliminated. It's as simple as that. It's a constitutional amendment. You give a fixed term and you bring in the German model, Article 67 of the German Constitution, which says there's a constructive no-confidence motion. Anybody who wishes to bring a no-confidence motion has to bring simultaneously a vote of confidence. If you don't bring a vote of confidence, sorry, your no-confidence lapses. It's as simple as that.
That is, hang on, that is actually a very practical solution.
Yes, it is. That's what
it's
our party suggests.
It's a practical solution and sounds like a very
simple... But that has not come from the BJP.
Whoever has come from, as I say, I'm coming to the politics.
The BJD has in writing.
And that can work in a small country like Germany. In a nation like India, we have so many states, so many different politics. It may not work. It may not be the right solution.
Look, for the moment, I am arrogating to myself during the course of this program the task of seeing whether it's a good idea and whether it's a feasible idea. So we're trying to find constructive solutions to this. He's come up with a constructive solution. Is it a viable solution?
No, it may not work because in India, you have governments which are formed of, say, 24 parties or 20 parties. So, parties moving, that will lead to much more IRAM than GARAM.
No, Pinaki is suggesting is something.
I'm not talking of 10 schedule. If, say, three parties decide to join the other group and they have the majority and they come up with...
Then those three parties may come back to you after six months
and that will happen constantly. So you will not have a single government.
Let me just try and understand.
No, that doesn't happen. It's not healthy for Indian democracy.
Let me just try and understand what Pinaki is saying, right? Yeah. What is wrong with it? I'm going to ask Sanjay, what's wrong with that thing? Mohammed, you can come in also on that. What he is simply suggesting is, you don't have a situation of whether assembly is being dissolved.
Yes.
You don't have a situation where the government will last for 5 years. You cannot bring down a chief minister or a prime minister unless you're in a position to form
a
different government.
That's the point I'm making.
So a minority part government can continue. The minute three parties in your case have gone to the other side, now they can form a government.
Yeah, they can form the government. And after six months, the four parties will come to the other side.
That's happening all the time.
But the government
continues. In the northeast, it's happening every second day.
It was IRAM, GARAM of individuals. Now it will be IRAM, GARAM of the parties.
Is that a practical solution? Chai thinks it's not. I'm not sure why that's not a practical solution.
No, he read out the provision of the constitution. If you make out, if you bring out that amendment, that is possible. Yes. And if you force government to last, the assemblies to last for 5 years,
that's right,
there won't be any premature fall of government. Yeah. You can fix the term of the
house. Give them a fixed tenure.
But the thing is it the right thing to do in a democratic process?
Is it the right thing to do is another point. Dr. Qureshi, on the practicalities of it, and I'm going to come back to everyone, including on the whether it's a good idea or not. The practical issue of what you were suggesting, Pinaki has made one possible suggestion to that just don't have it until there's a, you have to have a positive vote of confidence, not a negative vote of no confidence. So therefore, a government can never fall. You have to always have a government in place for 5 years. So no government will fall for 5 years.
No, you government can only, will change.
No. I mean, the assembly is there for 5 years.
Assembly won't fall, to it. But government
whoever's
will
in
fall.
Charge, it depends on whoever's commanding the majority on that moment. What's wrong with that idea? If anything.
Yes, that's a very, very good point. But the two reasons which were given by the Prime Minister is one is the money, the other is a prolonged period of model court, which leads to the disruption of normal activity. Can we look at an alternative route to solve this problem?
Yes.
For instance, 30,000 crores were spent in the last election because there is no cap on the political party's expenditure.
Yes.
Put a cap and 30,000 will come down to 3,000. One problem solved.
Actually, also, a cap Dr. Qureshi, with respect, a cap doesn't necessarily work because you could have any cap. Do you think political parties really keep to the caps they have? Look at the amount they spend. Look at the ads that we see. So I'm not sure those caps are being honored to start with.
Can I say something, Vishayanaji? There's a cap.
Let me just finish, Dr. Qureshi, then I'll come to you. Yeah.
It is followed for in breach.
You know, there are two alternative routes I'm giving. One, my suggestion about the cap on the political party expenditure. Secondly, there should be a complete ban on private fund collection, corporate money coming in, and then there will be state funding of political parties, not of election, because election expenditure is difficult to monitor. But we can give money to political parties based on actual votes they get. For 100 rupees, for every vote we give 100 rupees.
But that's
5 crores of
vote. Dr. Qureshi, that's broader. Those are broader reforms to the electoral process, which, I mean, let's try and solve one problem at a time. Those are good ideas. We'll have to come to that. Mohammed Khan, what's wrong with the suggestion that's being made out here?
One more point.
Yeah, finish what you're saying, Dr. Qureshi.
Other thing was, can we reduce the duration of election from 3.5 months to 33 days. I have a solution for that also. Let there be a single phase election, but let us be given more power parameters. We can finish the election in 33 days.
Okay. If it's simultaneous, you'll need a lot of security forces. Security. So if you don't,
First of all, I think a lot of very, very good points have been made in the panel, and they bear repeating or summarizing. The first argument that Vikas Saab and Shahid Saab made makes a lot of sense. The historical argument, 1951 to 73. Elections held simultaneously. 73 sees the emergence of smaller parties, leads to fractured mandates, lead to coalitions, which leads to governments not fulfilling their term. That's why today states go to elections at different points of time. 90s see the emergence.
Solution to that problem.
I'll come to that. 90s see the emergence of these parties on the national scene, where central governments are unable to fulfill their terms. Ike Gujral's term, Devegowda Saab's term, and before him, two others. Finally, this. Look, you do these simultaneous elections today. Shainaji said one or two states may have a problem later, they might dissolve. I want to put this in context. I've made a list of all the states that have been unable to complete their terms for one reason or the other over the last 10 years. Jammu Kashmir most recently, Delhi when Kejriwal first was unable to complete his term, Bihar when the Gadbandhan fell, Karnataka when Yadurappa was left the BJP for the first time, Meghalaya, Nagaland, Uttarakhand, Jharkhand. 9 states, that's a third of our country over the last 10 years. Are you saying these states will stay in abeyance? I don't know about the suggestion of the German constitution.
But he's come up with a solution to that problem.
I have a question.
That's
and
not
I agree
a democratic
with
solution.
Sir. Yeah, that's not a democratic solution. What is the meaning of adult franchise? We go to the public and they give us their option as to who they want to lead them or who they want to elect.
Yes.
This is a jugglery. Tell me how this, in fact, you know this pro-confidence solution? How does it work in Jammu and Kashmir where there are 4 parties? How does it work in Jammu and Kashmir? And
how
finally,
does it work
one,
in Jammu
no,
Kashmir?
One last question.
Okay, how did it work? Let's see the most recent example. Yeah. How did it work in Jammu? How does your idea work in Jammu and Kashmir? Mehbooba and the BJP refuse to talk to each other.
Nobody
wants to form a government. How does
it work in Jammu and Kashmir? What do you do in that scenario?
How did it work in Jammu and Kashmir?
I'll just answer that in a moment. The anti-democracy principle that Mr. Khan is talking about, people elect not chief ministers or prime ministers. People elect their MPs and MLAs. Please understand, we are a parliamentary
democracy.
With a larger
vision, sir.
We are a parliamentary
democracy. When I vote
democracy.
For an MP or an MLA, I'm voting for his party.
They will continue to have their MP and MLA for 5 years. The point is, who is in government? Now, as far as JNK is concerned, there will be short periods when there will be instability where the governors rule. That's why I'm not saying abolish governors rule. That's why president's rule and governor's rule is in the constitution, and that continues. So therefore, states eventually will get another government. There's no difficulty.
But if there's instability after 1 year, 4 years, you have governor's
exactly.
rule.
Well, but Vikramji, I want to make a larger point here, and this is a political point.
Look, yeah, I was coming to the politics now.
See, Shainaji, let us be under no illusions. There's the good of the public, and there's the good of Narendra Modi, and sometimes the two intersect. Okay, you have one campaigner, as Shahid Saab rightly pointed out, wo thak jate hain, aapko ek saath chunav karna, and I want to ask you something. Shahina ji keeps saying that, you know, we have to go to the states, we have to give priority to politics. Ma'am, who asks you to prioritize politics over governance? You've been elected to govern. Who asks you to take the entire cabinet to Gujarat? Who asks you to forget the nation and focus on by-elections? Madam, governments have existed before you in this setup. They have never made governance a casualty to their own personal political ambitions like you do. And you have admitted it on this channel. You and your colleagues say that, of course, governance suffers. It suffers because you don't give it the priority it deserves. So these simultaneous elections, these resources, this time that is being diverted to this debate is only for your own personal good and your personal convenience. It has nothing to do with the nation. The very fact that you don't even have a roadmap to talk of speaks volumes about the bankruptcy of this argument.
Okay, Shaina, your response.
The only party that doesn't want it is the Congress party for reasons best known to them.
Ma'am, 2010 the electoral commission ki report thi, wo hamare tenure ke dauran aayi thi.
Okay, Shaina, you
the chairman of the standing committee in
Let me get Shaina to respond.
The one that you're citing in support of simultaneous elections.
Mr. Khan, we've heard you. Shaina, respond, please.
I just want to say we are not a party that's living on our past laurels or riding on.
You have no past laurels.
That you know, Mr. vote Khan, for us because we have no vision. There is a vision. That vision is national interest. And if you understand that, you will understand that whether it's the Law Commission or the Election Commission of India, it is for them to advise, direct, and for us to abide. So it's not as if we have said that this is the mandate that we are wanting and this is what will happen. There are practicalities, there may be some difficulties too, but it is not a personal agenda, because do read the writing on the wall. 2019, Prime Minister Modi will win no matter what because of the
That's what
honesty,
you're trying to ensure. Unfortunately, you will not succeed. That is what we are trying to tell you. Forget elections. Focus on governance. You have 1 year left.
Mr. Khan, 1 second.
Progress and development work that we've done.
We know that in 2019.
I have one point to make.
We'll find it out.
New idea. And I'd like to quote here, Vikram.
Yeah.
A statesman thinks of the next generation. A politician is only thinking of the next
Modi ji is thinking about 2019 only, ma'am.
Yes.
If you want to save your money...
He's thinking of Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan.
He's thinking about 2019.
No, he's thinking of the next election.
There is no public good. Use these resources. Talk about farmers, unemployment. Talk about issues that concern the youth. Use this vital time and resources for better things.
But practical...
How much time, energy,
Mr. Khan, can she finish speaking? Okay, Mr. Khan, can she finish speaking? Okay, now that... Okay, one second. Shaina, I'm about to come back to you on a different point. Sanjay is trying to say something out here. Sanjay, politically now, having discussed all the other aspects of it, Shaina says there's nothing political about this. This is Narendra Modi thinking about the next generation and about the future. Is it political? Because you see, if you look at it, Shaina, just to add to what you were saying, it's an interesting list of the way political parties are viewing this. Samajwadi Party, TRS, Janata Dal United, Bodoland People's Party, Akali Dal, you know, these seem to be for it. Biju Janata Dal, of course, Trinamool, CPM, CPI. I'm not sure the DMK and AIADMK, which are there, they seem to be opposed to it. So it's not very clear what the parties are saying right now. How does it work?
See, I think this whole idea is like a big elephant of holding simultaneous election. And why do I say this? Elephant has two kinds of teeth. The two teeth which is always hanging outside, which is always beautiful, and we see it and appreciate it. If we get a chance to buy, we put it in our drawing room. The whole logic, the whole argument that this is going to reduce the cost on election is like the big teeth. We are all looking at the big teeth and everybody is appreciating. Who is not going to appreciate reducing cost on election? But we don't see the teeth inside. The danger which Shahid Bhai was mentioning, that you take a medicine, it cures you of one element, but it can create all kinds of other problems. That's the danger. And what's the danger? Let me give you a data and for everyone to think, what's the danger behind that? He also hinted about the federal character of the country. Since 1989, there have been 31 instances of state and Lok Sabha going to polls simultaneously. 31 instances. What is the electoral outcome? 24 cases, the big party got yes. almost same amount of vote in the state assembly election and in the Lok Sabha election. Yeah. Only 7 instances when the people made careful choice of voting differently for the Lok Sabha and for the assembly. 3 times it happened in Tamil Nadu in 89, 91 and 96. Once in Andhra, once in Haryana, and one in one of the...
Tamil Nadu is a unique case.
So the problem, the teeth which is inside, we are not able to see what the problem is coming. The problem is all these smaller regional parties are going to disappear very soon.
Okay.
Because the big event always take over the
smaller. That's an interesting point. Vikas, and let me get everyone in on this, because I think that's a very important point. Vikas, thesis he is suggesting is that the big danger in this is that whoever the big, and that's probably perhaps one reason why the BJP obviously wants this, any big national party with a really big towering leader like the BJP has in Narendra Modi, that one factor will lead people to vote in state elections in the same way as they're voting for the national election. So they are going in to vote in the polls saying, we are going to vote for Modi as prime minister, and they'll end up voting in the state elections in the same manner. That's the concern, that's the risk that he has. Do you think it's a viable concern? And there's data for that, he's saying.
I don't agree with this theory, because I don't think that our voters are so immature. And this has happened in state after state. I'm not carrying statistics like my friend is carrying. But I'll tell you one thing. As far as whatever be the inner teeth, I'm not looking at the inner teeth, but nobody can say that this is not a good thing. Politically, what they can do without a constitutional amendment is that at least while they have the 19 elections, the Lok Sabha election, whatever assemblies that are likely to come for election in the next 2 or 3 months or 6 or 4, 5, 6 months, they can have all of them together and at least have one large poll together, which will be a political call. That will not be a legal call.
Okay.
That will be a political
call. So I'm glad Vikas said this, because I really, the BJP needs to put its money where its mouth is. Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, and now Mizoram, these 4 states,
yes.
if they don't want to prepone the parliament elections, have presidents rule and take these elections simultaneously.
Absolutely.
They can easily, why would the others agree to that?
It's all their own governments. It's all their own governments. They're all BJP-led governments, and the prime minister's fiat runs.
So six months both ways.
Then number. You have the earlier in fact, because I would suggest even
later,
more.
Have them all together.
Because I would suggest even Bihar, which goes to elections
possible?
In 2000. Yes, it is.
Can Maharashtra, Haryana.
Politically, you can do
Maharashtra,
that.
Haryana, but legally, can you do that? These are all staggered in 2019.
What would the Congress party say if they said,
The Congress party has no presence anywhere, don't worry. The Congress party has no presence anywhere.
All these are BJP states. Yeah, but Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh are states that they're hoping
to win. Can I say something?
It won't depend on the Congress party. It will depend on the election commission and the prime minister. If the chief minister there imposes president's rule, because you know, otherwise they would have to extend their assembly, which can't be done. It has to be for 5 years. So in today's constitutional scenario, so then you have president rule for 3 months, and you have elections.
Is that a possibility?
You have elections in February, March, April.
So Pinaki Saab is legally correct.
Absolutely.
There's no denying the fact that states.
But then again, it's undemocratic.
Or you prepone your elections and have them in November.
So Pinaki Saab is right.
Politically, you have one large.
No,
you have 17, 18 states.
That's what they are moving towards. One at a time.
Even then, you can move elections forward a month or two, or you can advance them by a month or two. Mayawati did that when she was in power. Other states have also done
that. We did 1 year.
You guys have done 1 year as well. So states do have that autonomy, of course. But legally, correct. But politically, everybody would see that the BJP is serving its whole goal. And frankly, I would tell you another thing. This argument that the BJP will sweep elections if they're held together, I completely disagree with that. Pinaki Saab should only tell us otherwise.
Of course.
Right? Odisha and other states have attested to the fact. And Tamil and Andhra Pradesh and Telangana attested
to the fact. Odisha, the Biju Janata Dal won both in the.
Simultaneously.
Whether they
won simultaneously, there was no difference in Odisha. So Biju Janata Dal won both Lok Sabha and
Assembly. Let me add,
I'm in complete disagreement with Sanjay Saab on one thing, that the big behemoth political parties, you know, have a huge advantage. Let me tell you, when I fought 3 elections from the Congress and I fought 2 elections from the BJD, let me tell you, the Congress party or the BJP for that matter, the smallest seat in East Mizoram and New Delhi Parliament seat, there is the same kind of fight going on when tickets are being distributed. For a local party, we have 147 assembly, 21 parliament, we are like a You know, it's like an army unit which goes in.
But can I just add one statement?
Regional parties actually benefit.
No, one statement. If you spoke about Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh.
You asked about
Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. If and only if they take Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh and postpone the election for it to coincide with the general election, then inki niyat ke baare mein kisi ko doubt nahi rahega. You know, the only way they work and retain political capital is if they do it with all 19 states. They have to do it in all 19 states where they're in power.
But they may still prefer if what he's saying is legally possible, they may still prefer to do that.
But politically hypocritical unless they do it in all 19 states.
Losing in Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh and then going for a general
election. That is a real point, Vikram. Because ultimately, the politics of it is that they're afraid that if they go to polls in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh before the 2019 Lok Sabha election and lose there, and it seems that they are losing there. If they lose there, then they will have a very difficult roadmap in 2019. Okay. And therefore, they want to have simultaneous elections in these three states. Okay. So they are talking about it now, but they want, basically what they want is simultaneous elections. Either they prepone the Lok Sabha elections or postpone these three assembly elections.
So after one hour of discussing, it's all politics, guys, can I please get China? At the end of the day, after 1 hour of discussing all aspects of the theory behind simultaneous election, whether it's good or bad, we eventually come down to the political conspiracy theory that at the end of it,
it's a political theory
that what we are really pushing for here, or what the BJP is really pushing for here, is to say somehow postpone Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh to the general election, or bring the general election to when Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh are. You don't want to go for the general election after losing in these states, potentially. That's the theory. What do you feel?
It's a sensible thing to do.
Wishful thinking and these conspiracy theories only hold good in a television debate or for your TRPs. The fact that the BJP has won 21 states in the country is not something that we are arrogant about. We are not for
Ma'am,
one
do
minute saying
aapke
that the people's verdict and mandate is not important. It's extremely important. But if we are able to do with this kind of appeasement politics, vote bank politics, money spent, and actually make sure that public servants who are here for good governance and development of the country focus on that, then I think we would have a mature debate. But for those who are worried about our destiny and our future, let me please tell them to be worried about where they stand today. Because for the first time in the history of India, do you have an honest government that is actually doing development work? And that's why you've seen these 21 victories.
Where is this Vikas, ma'am? That's what we've been asking for the last 4 years.
Okay, okay, listen, guys, where is this all Vikas? Of this will happen in the political campaign. Please pause on this till November, December. I'm sure we will have
it. That too, not on its own steam. But this is not the issue. The voter of India, don't undermine them. They are extremely intelligent to know who they want to vote for, how they want to vote, and this is not a panic button at all.
Ma'am, you have coalition governments in five states. You should tell your partners as well.
Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan.
Okay, fine. We will find out. We will find out what actually happened in China, and we will see whether this was a conspiracy theory or not.
Dying legacy.
Okay, we will come back in November and December. We'll see if it was a conspiracy theory. If it's not a conspiracy theory,
people have dismissed and discarded.
Ma'am, agar aap do seaton se wapas aa sakte
ho, to 40 se to zarur aa
sakte ho. Ladies and gentlemen, us. That's why we are bold enough to take gutsy decisions, whether it's demonetization or GST or decisions that take a lot of hard metal to take courageous decisions in national interest.
Okay, China, Mohammad Khan, you have one full year for the elections unless the conspiracy theory is right and we have it in 6-7 months. We will find out what is actually going to happen in that. Thank you all so much for joining us on this. But Dr. Qureshi, I'm going to get you in on the last word on this, on the technicalities of what was just being suggested out here. Is that at all a feasibility that this is actually not something, this is actually a trial balloon for a possible scenario where either the assemblies are suspended in Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh to have the elections together with the Lok Sabha, or that the Lok Sabha election is advanced to November, December? Is that a feasible possibility in your view?
Well, instead of making a political comment, I would like to say that Prime Minister has not pushed it down the throat of the nation, and it's good that he has asked for a national debate, which is exactly what is happening. Let us see what is the outcome of the debate. Also, but coming back to your question, if limited the simultaneous election can be done in the context of the four states by advancing the Lok Sabha election, I think that will be a very good pilot project. Let us see.
All right. Dr. Qureshi, thank you for joining that. I'm afraid you're flat out of time, so we're going to have to leave it there. Thank you so much for joining us, and you know, let's just wait and see what happens. An interesting idea, simultaneous elections. Other interesting ideas are tied to that, such as the concept of a positive vote of confidence as opposed to a negative vote of confidence. Is any of this about to happen in the next few months? Well, we'll have to wait and see, won't we? That's a big fight. We'll be back next week. Bye for now.